Tonight on NewsWatch, deadly drone attacks, the latest on the controversial tactics used in the fight against terrorism.
Plus, it's a battle over business between California and Texas. Why income taxes could determine who wins the fight.
And the miraculous way God is moving in the Muslim world. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. Good evening. I'm Mark Martin.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. More questions from Congress today about the Obama administration's use of drone strikes to target Americans working for Al-Qaeda overseas.
CBN News has team coverage on the controversy over drones, beginning with this report from Heather Sells.
Since President Obama took office in 2009, the use of drones has grown 700%. This week, the country learned that America launches them from a secret base in Saudi Arabia. And we also learned that the government thinks it's okay to use drones to kill Americans overseas if an informed high-level official believes that citizen poses an imminent threat. A Justice Department document shows that no clear evidence is needed. Human rights advocates disagree.
That justifies essentially a claim that the executive branch can be judge, jury, and executioner.
One recent example, in 2011, the U.S. killed Anwar al-Awlaki in a drone strike in Yemen. He was an American citizen, but also a top al-Qaeda leader linked to several terror attacks. Many in the military believe that drone strikes will grow in importance in the future, but that more thoughtful debate about their use is needed.
If the threshold gets too low and we are too casual about it, then we will forget how much scar tissue we build up in those countries.
And that scar tissue is already growing. In Pakistan alone, drone strikes have killed thousands of terrorists, but also more than 300 civilians. Heather Sells, CBN News.
A man with keen knowledge about the administration's use of drone attacks is President Obama's nominee to be CIA Director John Brennan. He faced the Senate Intelligence Committee for his confirmation hearing this afternoon, but he also faced several interruptions from war protesters.
Please remove that
woman. The CIA and the Obama administration refused to even tell Congress.
The committee briefly halted the hearing to clear the protesters from Code Pink. When it resumed, he said the fight against al-Qaeda is far from over.
If given the honor to serve as the 21st director of the CIA, I would take it as a in my ability to make sure this Central Intelligence Agency is the absolute best intelligence service it can be and one that makes all Americans proud.
Brennan said America is still at war with al-Qaeda and is under daily cyber attack by foreign enemies.
Joining us now from Washington is our congressional correspondent, John Jessup. John has been following Brennan's confirmation hearing. John, President Obama originally wanted John Brennan for the job 4 years ago. What's changed this time around to make the White House think Brennan can win the nomination?
Well, Mark, you're right. 4 years ago, Brennan withdrew his nomination, fearing that he'd be too much of a lightning rod, given that the fact that he had deep familiarity with the CIA's enhanced interrogation techniques, trying to extract information from suspected terrorists during the Bush administration. 4 years later, though, he's seen as a man with much more credibility. He's a trusted Obama advisor, advising him on national security and counterterrorism. He's got 25 years of service with the CIA and is widely seen as President Obama's architect on Obama's war on al-Qaeda. But that doesn't mean that he's without controversy. Republicans will press him on leaked security details in the run-up to last year's election cycle, and both parties will ask him about the use of drones. It's something that he was the first to acknowledge within the Obama administration and something that he supports. So, of course, we've been hearing a lot more about that in recent days, and he's going to be getting a grilling on Capitol Hill just about that.
Well, the issue of drones has been in the news for a while. Why did the White House decide to release memos outlining their legal basis now?
Well, it's been interesting, as you said, it's been out in the media for quite a bit. The thing that has made it different is the fact that the administration has been very, very secretive about drones, about its legal basis. Of course, there was a recent leaked memo that said that it was okay for the government to kill Americans who are suspected of working with Al-Qaeda overseas. So you had an interesting scenario beginning to play out. You had Democratic senators, namely Senator Ron Wyden of Oregon, who suggested he might even block Brennan's nomination if the administration didn't come forward with more information. So this was kind of an attempt to allay some of those concerns.
Okay, John Jessup, thanks for your time. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Mark.
Well, no vote in the Senate today on former Senator Chuck Hagel's nomination for defense secretary. The vote was postponed after Republicans raised questions about who paid Hagel for some of his speeches and consulting work. They want to know if Hagel got any money directly or indirectly from foreign sources. They also want to know why Hagel has refused to answer those questions, and they say they can't vote on his nomination until they have all the information they need.
Iran's supreme leader rejected a proposal today for direct talks with the United States. Ayatollah Khamenei was responding to an offer made by Vice President Joe Biden to speak one-on-one on a range of topics, including Iran's disputed nuclear program. The Ayatollah told members of Iran's Air Force that bilateral talks with the U.S. would not solve any problems. According to a report by an Iranian news agency, Khamenei says, "You Americans have pointed guns toward Iran, but at the same time, you want to negotiate. The Iranian nation will not be intimidated by these actions." His remarks come as new U.S. sanctions against Iran continue to be imposed, including new restrictions on payments for Iranian oil. Iran is expected to participate in nuclear talks with the UN Security Council and Germany later this month in Kazakhstan. Experts say the Ayatollah's remarks today suggest Iran will stick to demands for relief from economic pressure before considering any nuclear concessions. Meanwhile, Iran's president says the Islamic Republic is already a nuclear state. That's what Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad told an Egyptian newspaper this week. And some security experts say he may not be far from the truth. Retired Israeli General Amos Yadlin claims Iran has all the material it needs to build a nuclear bomb. He says it only needs 4 to 6 months to enrich enough military-grade uranium to build a bomb.
In the eye of the Iranians, 4 to 6 months are too long time. And the situation in the world is not such that they think that they can get away with it. They want the time of breakout to be much shorter, and they are waiting for international crisis that the attention will be moved from them.
Yadlin says the Iranians could cross Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's red line to take action against Iran sometime this year. Netanyahu told lawmakers earlier this week that stopping Iran from arming itself with nuclear weapons will be the supreme mission of a new unity government.
Here at home, it's a battle over business between the governors of Texas and California. Texas Governor Rick Perry is urging businesses to leave California because of their high taxes and move to Texas. But California Governor Jerry Brown is firing back. Ephraim Graham reports.
Building a business is tough. But I hear building a business in California is next to impossible.
Texas Governor Rick Perry has his sights set on California's business owners. He's hitting the airwaves to solicit companies to move to the Lone Star State.
I have a message for California businesses. Come check out Texas.
California Governor Jerry Brown dismissed the radio ads in colorful language, sending the message he doesn't believe anyone will actually leave. But California could actually be on the losing end of this battle. Critics say Perry's ads highlight the issues that have dragged down businesses in the Golden State for years.
The taxes are high, the regulations are onerous. There's a lot of things keeping them from being able to innovate and to grow their business.
And it's not just a problem for businesses. It's also getting awfully expensive to be a millionaire there. Phil Mickelson, the championship golfer, recently suggested he might leave California for a state with no personal income tax. He often collects million-dollar purses for his tournaments, and California's new 13.3% state income tax, combined with high federal taxes, is hitting him hard. For example, Sunday, Mickelson won more than $1 million in a Phoenix tournament. Automatically, 40% went to the federal government, 13.3% went to the state of California, and 5% went to the state of Arizona. That means 58.3% of the original purse went to taxes. Governor Perry was quick to offer Mickelson some Texas hospitality. In a Twitter message, he said, quote, "Hey, Phil, Texas is home to liberty and low taxes. We would love to have you as well." Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Well, the Northeast is bracing for what's being called a potentially historic blizzard. The National Weather Service says the storm will begin Friday morning and last through Saturday. Some areas of New England could see more than 2 feet of snow. Road crews have their salt trucks and sand ready to go, and folks in the area are wasting no time gearing up for the snowy conditions.
We want to make sure we stock up and have some extra supplies. Our snowblower was in for repairs, so I figured I would get some shovels.
Forecasters say the snow coupled with high winds could cause blizzard conditions that will make traveling hazardous.
Coming up, has America seen the end of the Tea Party movement?
It's probably something I've had for many years, and every year the PSA would be a little higher. I just kept kind of ignoring it. You know, one of those guy things. It'll go away. It'll go away. Finally, one day, Janet says, "You're going to the doctor." They did a blood test. My PSA was 14. I needed to get a second opinion, so we contacted Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com.
The really great thing is that you just go online, and if you have prostate or lung cancer or whatever, you can see what their survival rates are.
You can also check for participating insurance plans. Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity and the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America go way beyond what normal hospitals do. I knew that they had the technology to take care of my cancer. It's a device called Calypso.
Calypso is GPS for the prostate. We're able to get four-dimensional real-time tracking of prostate movement during radiation treatment.
It eliminates a lot of my side effects. It makes sense. It just makes sense. I own a deli. I'm back at work. My customers come in and say, "Gosh, you look good." And some of them say, "I look better now than I did before I left." I didn't expect to learn a lesson about how to treat people by being in a hospital. You can tell when somebody really cares.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Today in Washington, Americans put their political differences aside and focused on their shared faith in Jesus Christ. Thousands gathered for the National Prayer Breakfast. President Obama says his second inauguration caused him to focus on the power of faith.
Sometimes I search scripture to determine how best to balance life as a president and as a husband and as a father. I often search for scripture to figure out how I can be a better man as well as a better president. And I believe that we are united in these struggles. But I also believe that we are united in the knowledge of a redeeming Savior whose grace is sufficient for the multitude of our sins and whose love is never failing.
World-renowned Dr. Benjamin Carson gave the keynote address proclaiming Jesus is his role model. Standing just feet from the president, Dr. Carson criticized higher taxes on the wealthy and advocated changes to the healthcare system that promote personal responsibility, not more government control.
Just a couple of years ago, the Tea Party was the most powerful force in politics. Now some political experts are asking, is it dead? Some politicians say yes, and so do some in the media. But as David Brody reports, the Tea Party itself plans to have the final word.
The predictions began soon after election night 2012. CNN declared the end of the Tea Party movement, and the Washington Post exclaimed how the movement will soon be nothing more than a blip in the country's collective memory. Mitt Romney's loss, combined with a few Tea Party stumbles, led to a perception that the so-called movement was a bunch of ultra-conservatives who cost Republicans congressional seats. Within the GOP establishment, they're seen as a nuisance who just won't compromise.
That's the same 40, 50 chuckleheads that all year, starting with H.R. 1, the entire Congress have screwed this place up.
Now, GOP guru Karl Rove could be looking to put a nail in the coffin, too. His new political action committee, the Conservative Victory Project, will be backing electable candidates during GOP primaries in 2014. The Tea Party reads the word electable as code for squishy moderate Republicans, and that has them seen red.
So here is a project funded by crony capitalists, funded by corporatists who are not conservative.
The Tea Party says, much like Mark Twain, reports of its death have been greatly exaggerated. While polls show Tea Party identification dropping from 24% in 2010 to just 8% today, there have been key wins. Newly minted Senators Ted Cruz and Deb Fischer join a growing constitutional conservative group made up of Marco Rubio, Mike Lee, Tim Scott, and Rand Paul. In the House, more than 50 Tea Party members make up a strong voting bloc. Ultimately, Tea Party leaders say the key to a sustainable national movement is electing House and Senate candidates who are ready for prime time.
We require our candidates for endorsement to have a path to victory in their campaign.
Julie Turner is president of the Texas Patriots. Turner says the way to keep the movement on track is by grooming candidates on the local level and growing a bench of all-stars.
It became clear to us that what we needed to do was to build kind of a farm team, start at the easiest elections, bring people into our weekly meetings.
Here in San Antonio, the Alamo has come to represent the ultimate sacrifice in freedom. And that's exactly the way the Tea Party sees themselves, as freedom warriors. And so when everybody talks about whether or not the Tea Party is dead, well, here in Texas, it's anything but. The Tea Party kept a serious presence in the state capitol, convincing lawmakers to rein in spending. In places like Beaumont and many other cities, Tea Party members meet each week to plot strategy.
A lot of people like to see us give up, but that's not going to happen.
For people that think the Tea Party is dead, what's your message to them?
No, the Tea Party's not dead. I think they're resting.
Much like their GOP counterparts, image is a problem. Since the media has turned the Tea Party into a four-letter word, conservative bloggers suggest a four-part strategy: rebrand, retool, recruit, and re-engage.
This is generational. It started with the founding of this country. It will always happen. Our name will change. The faces will change. The principles will not.
David Brody, CBN News, in Beaumont, Texas.
Up next, more and more Muslims coming to Christ through dreams and visions.
My feet hurt, your feet hurt. White hot pain, I wanna cry. Is there anything I can try?
Why, yes. Introducing Strut Soul Angels, the human shock absorber that helps alleviate foot pain.
The first 10 steps in the morning to the bathroom were excruciating. Within 3 days after I put Struts on, it's been such a relief.
Slipped it on and almost immediately I felt a support, kind of like a pillow underneath my arches.
The Struts Soul Angel provides a great amount of relief and support throughout the course of the day, providing shock absorption and relief of pain.
On your feet without proper support can be painful. Struts Soul Angels promotes better balance, control, and body alignment. Standing in your heels all day is painful, but slip on Struts and you'll enjoy comfort and support 24/7. Struts is so versatile, you'll wear them in every shoe you own, even barefoot.
I'm on my feet all the time. I teach 11 and 12 year olds. The pain was so much that I knew I had to do something. And with the Struts, I can do my job and enjoy my job.
I usually am on my feet from 8 to 12 hours a day. When I wear my Struts, it's like giving my feet a hug all day.
It's life changing. I wear them from the minute I get up
the minute I go to bed.
Why pay $400 for custom orthotics?
Now get Strut's Soul Angels for just $10. You also get Miracle Foot Repair Cream, absolutely free. Use it to help relieve dry, callous feet overnight. But wait, call right now and we'll double the offer free. Just pay separate processing and handling. Plus, you get a 100% money-back guarantee. If not completely delighted, send it back. But keep the foot cream as our gift just for trying. You get it all. A $70 value for just $10.
Oh, yes! Love my struts. The best thing since sliced bread. They heal pain from toes to head. Get yours now, your doctor said.
Struts. Be nice to your feet. Call now.
Call 1-800-787-1580 and get your struts and miracle foot repair for just $10 and we'll double the offer. That's 1-800-787-1580 or visit getstruts.com.
Dreaming dreams and seeing visions of Jesus. It's happening today and not just among Christians.
Yeah, it's really exciting. Across the Muslim world, men and women are coming to Christ because Jesus has appeared to them. Chris Mitchell has tonight's Focus Report.
Hey guys, my name is Hazem.
Hazem Faraz hosts a satellite TV program for Muslims called Reflections. He says he hears from Muslims all the time who tell him they had a dream or vision of Jesus Christ that forever changed their lives.
I had one lady write me and said, I had a nightmare. And she said, I turned on the television and there you were. And she said, and the words that were coming out of your mouth were so peaceful, I fell asleep. And she said, and when I fell asleep, I ended up having a vision of Jesus. She said, I saw the Lord. She wasn't a believer. She said, I saw the Lord Jesus, and he was in a bright white robe. He pointed to a man who I knew in the dream was Abraham. And he was sacrificing Isaac. And she said, as soon as I looked over, I had known that Jesus was the Christ, sacrificed the Son of God.
Across the Muslim world, from Indonesia to Morocco, Muslim men and women are turning to faith in Jesus Christ in unprecedented numbers. For many, their conversions are not simply the result of missionaries or preachers sharing the gospel with them. Instead, these Muslims are coming to Christ because they've had dreams and visions where Jesus himself appears to them. Ali also met Jesus in a dream while on his way to Mecca for the Muslim pilgrimage called the Hajj.
Of course, when I went to Mecca, I was going there in order to pay homage to the Kaaba and to fulfill the requirements in Islam.
Ali's experience in Mecca is dramatized in this DVD called More Than Dreams.
But that night, I saw Jesus in a dream. First, Jesus touched my forehead with his finger. And after touching me, he said, you belong to me. And then he touched me above my heart. You have been saved. Follow me. You belong to me, he said. So I decided, okay, I am not going to finish the Hajj, the pilgrimage. Whatever it takes, I am going to follow that voice.
The DVD tells of other Muslims who came to faith in Jesus through a dream or vision.
We're seeing that all around. We're hearing about people that have never even thought about Jesus as Savior. They're content Muslims and they're having dreams over and over.
Tom Doyle serves in E3 Ministries. He and his wife Joanne share the gospel with Muslims. Doyle also wrote the recently released book, Dreams and Visions, Is Jesus Awakening the Muslim World?
I think our God is a fair God. He's righteous and just. People are seeking. They don't know where to go. Maybe they don't have a Bible. Maybe there's no missionary in the village. He'll get the message to him somehow.
This woman comes from a Central Asian country. Her identity is hidden for security reasons.
In the church, if you ask how people came to Christ, 80% will say they saw him in a dream.
A Christian friend challenged this woman to ask God to speak to her personally.
So I decided to ask him, and so I did. And then the next day, I guess, I saw a dream, and in my dream, I saw Jesus was a bridge. I decided to come to him.
Doyle says the dream or vision is usually the start, not the end of a Muslim's conversion.
You know, nobody goes to sleep, Chris, a Muslim and wakes up a Christian, but it knocks down the false barriers that are inherent in Islam. A couple of them are that we worship three gods, that the Bible's corrupted.
The Doyles say compared to the political storm sweeping the Middle East, this could be seen as a spiritual earthquake.
You know what? As things heat up politically and spiritually within Islam, man, the Holy Spirit's moving even more powerfully.
This is the time when hearts are open, people are desperate, governments are changing, everybody's foundation has massive cracks in it, and Jesus is the answer that can come in and fill that need.
Many veteran missionaries say these dreams and visions, combined with satellite television, are reaching Muslims in unprecedented numbers. They say more Muslims are coming to Jesus Christ than at any other time in the 1400-year history of Islam. The Doyles say believers in the West can join the spiritual revolution.
So yes, I think that, you know, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And, you know, we are committed, all of us as believers, we've got to reach those with the gospel of Christ.
Not everybody's going to go to the Middle East, but they can pray. And no government, no leader can block intercession around the world. That's one thing that can get into any country. So we need to pray as believers that God would continue to just push the gospel out to the ends of the earth.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Up next, America's longest married couple speaks out about their love story.
Listen up for an amazing offer that can change the way you hear.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. Can you repeat that?
Frustrated with your hearing?
What did he say?
Well, hear better now. Introducing the fully rechargeable MSA30X, a revolutionary device that features the latest microsound amplification technology that can barely be seen. Independently tested to help you hear up to 30 times better. It turns ordinary hearing into extraordinary hearing. MSA30X works by capturing and amplifying sound waves, yet its lightweight ergoacoustic design is discreet. It form fits in and around either ear.
I forget I'm even wearing it.
An MSA30X is powerful. Hear clearly in restaurants. Never miss another word on TV or at the movies.
My wife complains that I have the volume up on the TV too loud.
And I didn't want to be in the same room with them.
Now I can hear everything clearly.
Simply adjust the volume as you desire. Other units use so many batteries and they're difficult to change. But the MSA30X is completely rechargeable. Simply plug it into the wall.
I tried other devices that had batteries, but they were always such a pain to change and so costly. But this is rechargeable, so I figure I save hundreds a year.
Bulky sound amplifiers can cost hundreds, but try MSA30X for just $59.95 and we'll include a cleaning brush and 5 comfort tips. But wait. In this special TV offer, we'll cut the price in half. Now you can hear up to 30 times better for just $29.95. But there's even more. We'll double the offer free. Just pay additional processing and handling. Wear them both or give one to a loved one. Did you hear that? That's 2 MSA30Xs for just $29.95. The MSA30X Hear Better Now offer. Get 2 for just $29.95.
All I can say is just try it. It could change your life.
To order the MSA30X sound amplifier, call 1-800-535-0654. That's 1-800-535-0654. Or you can go to msa30x.com. Call or go online now.
Valentine's Day is just 1 week away, and we have a love story for you tonight.
And not just any love story, Mark. John and Ann Bittar are America's longest married couple. John is 101 years old. Ann, just 97, and they've been married for, get this, 80 years. They met in Bridgeport, Connecticut, where their houses were right across the street from each other. Anne's parents had actually arranged for her to marry someone else, but she and John had other plans, so they eloped. They got married in 1932 and have been by each other's side ever since.
Oh, we just fell in love, that's all.
Your love grows, you know, and it grows in very good directions for the two of us.
May you all be as fortunate as we are.
Oh my goodness, they look fantastic.
They do, wow.
John and Ann have 5 children, 14 grandchildren, and 16 great-grandchildren. They've been fruitful and multiplied. Well done, John and Ann.
Yeah, what an inspiration.
Yeah, awesome. Well, that's all for this edition of NewsWatch.
Yeah, thanks for watching. Have a great night.